All right, here's my surprise. I was preparing this morning, and the Lord just dealt with me about calling some brothers. And I could have got this from the Lord last week, but he didn't give it to me. And I could have had all of them warned and prepared, but then some of them would have gone on the internet and got something. But I wanted this to be straight from the heart this morning. Here's what the Lord impressed upon me. Okay, I like to call at least about three brothers that would like to express in their own way. Well, it doesn't matter how colorful your past has been. We want you to articulate what you would like best to be remembered for as a father. Amen. What qualities, what traits, what characteristics that you would like to be remembered for as a father. And I don't think that that's something that you have to dwell on for a week or so, or pray through to get a word from the Lord. I believe this is something that any man that really has his family at heart could do spontaneously or from the top of their head and without a whole lot of preparation. So I'm just going to open it up. And if the ones that the Lord laid on my heart don't come, I will call them. But we'll make it voluntary at first, initially, okay? Isn't that exciting?
Yeah.
All right. Who's going to be first?
That stood out to me to know that she missed me, she needed me, she wanted me, and of course
that even just transcends over to all three of my kids also. And so I know that without a father's presence in the lives of our children, they do need it. They do want it. It has to be there. And I was proud to give that to them, what they needed as a father. And even to this very day, when I get that phone call and I can look at that phone, and I can say, you know what? That's a money call. I'm gonna let that one go to voicemail. So I can say, you know, that's a babysitting call. I'm gonna let that one go to voicemail too. You know, so you can just kind of feel those things. But really, just the attitude that I had toward my kids, I've always felt like I was a great father. I always feel like I'm a great grandfather. That will never change. I am so grateful that they are around, and I could not imagine if they were not here on this earth where I would be. And I could not imagine that, you know, they just turned my life around so completely. I feel like I'm a much better man, a much better father because of them, and now that's even going over into grandfatherhood. I see a lot of the personalities of my grandkids in their parents, and that's always great. So I'm just having a great time with them. So I'd like to be remembered, first off, for just loving and caring for them in their early ages, being there whenever they needed me, doing whatever they needed me to do for them, setting the ground rules for them as well, you know, the spankings and all of that comes along with all of that. Hey, I want to be remembered for that. And I can hear it in their grandkids that, they've been teaching them that. So it's always great just to know that they listened to you when you were telling them something, even though there were times when they probably regretted listening to you. So I've always had a great time. So I just appreciate them, and I appreciate being a father. Those are the memories that I have most. And now in my latter part of my life, the latter stages of my life, since I've given my life to Christ, it is an example for them. And I hope that they are once again watching the picture of their dad. So I want them to see that. One daughter has actually started attending church, she and her family. I've got one more to go that's being kind of a rebel towards doing that. I've got a son and his wife who are slowly coming around as well, but they're all recognizing it. I can see it and I can feel it. So I know that the example that I'm setting is a good example. And that's what I most like to be remembered for, is that I set a great example for them.
To press in and to see God. And that's the thing about that I want to live with them more than anything is, you know, no matter what going on in their life, even things don't seem to line up as they desire, but it's to continue and press on and to seek after Him. Even if the thing that that the enemy just continue to throw their way, and first or foremost, to run to the Word of God, and He'll allow Him to bring you the victory through your in your life that you need. Because truly, you go, you know, they facing different sort of circumstances. Even they today, they become older, I guess you could say, more mature. And I think it seems like sometimes I think they call me more now. I think I like him when he was young. But you know, because then you kind of, you know, you kind of have your way with them. Or, you know, now they're, you know, growing on their own. Sometimes they just listen to dad's voice, and sometimes they, you know, yeah. But but you know, they have been a truly a pleasure and a blessing. And to me, it's coming up, you know, I'm not getting old, as older and wiser, and they have come to my age. And that's the thing that I always look for, inspect, and when things not going my way, they encourage me with the Word. And the same thing likewise with them, I have to remind them, this is what the Word says. And they, you know and understand that, well, maybe daddy may not be feeling right, or something might be going on. And they come together and they lay hand on that. So I mean, these things are, you know, very precious. Yes. You begin to see what you have imparted them begin to come to realization. Yes. And to see them mature up. And they always talk faith about what they believe in God for and who their God are. Yes. And that's what I desire them more than anything, to become, you know, not so much depending on our faith, but their faith. They stand and see the salvation of God moving on their behalf. And be able to stand against that every wild of devil and come out victorious. And then, you know, as we, you know, sometimes we impart things, we want our kids to, you know, do exactly the same thing we do and live the same way. And sometimes they go through a different change. Well, through it all, like the scripture said, praise to the righteous. Praise God, shall be saved. And that's the utmost and important thing for them, for me and my eyes, to see them walking in victory through their everyday circumstances. And so I'm truly a blessed man, and thank God for, you know, able to be in the Father. Because I can remember a time in my early part of my life for the information that was given that I wasn't going to be a father through auto accident that I was involved with then. But who knows? Doctors don't always have the right word. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. God always has the last say so. And I always say the first and the last, because He is the beginning and the end. Hallelujah. And you put your trust in Him, He'll never make you ashamed. Praise God. And that's why I said I'm truly blessed and see that He made the devil lie when he's spoken in my life. And now, you know, they are, you know, of course, you know, it's an example of what, you know, if you trust in God, what would take place. And truly, that's the legacy I desire for them to remember about, just the man of God, just want to serve God, a man of prayer, and seeking after Him, a man to love their mom, you know, taking care of them, providing for them, and providing for them, the man to work, had good ethics, don't mind working, mind doing hard work, mind figuring out how to work on a car, even though he don't know how to work a car, but they think I do. And somehow I know all these things they think I know how to do, but, I mean, they call me about those things, but nevertheless, I get out there and try, and like I said, my method is, well, I either fix it or I tear it up. So that's, you know, it been working pretty good for me at this point in time. So, but anyway, talk to this girl.
Father's Day. Amen. declare that I am a man of God and I live a life of God. I reach out to people I reach out to, I show them the love of God. But thinking back over my life, there were some times in my life that I didn't live this way. And those things, I did a lot of things coming up that I probably will be remembered for, good things. Because, you know, like I said, before I came to Christ, yeah, I was a person. But I got away from the I used to know all the latest music that was out. In fact, I did a little DJ. Around 12 or two. But those things are far gone now. And I have tried to live a life before my kids that were, they would know who their Savior is. And when they're tied to trouble, that they will run to God. Because He is the only shelter that they need. And thinking about my daughters, I think I spoiled them. Yeah, because, you know, I used to tell them all the time, you know, when a man finds a wife, he finds a good wife.
Amen.
And so they stand at home and they wait on somebody to come, I guess. And when somebody comes to the house, they see me, they don't want to stay alone. That might have been a hindrance, but I still believe in that God has the man for him. They're just not ready for him yet. So the things that instilled in my daughters, I'm proud of. And I know that when I'm gone, they'll remember me for those. And I think of what my father used to say a lot of that. I used to say, man, he sure was old. Don't he know we don't do this stuff like that no more? You know, that's when I was a teenager. And then I became a young adult. I realized, you know, my dad was pretty smart. And now that I'm older than I am now, my dad was real smart. You know, he told me some things back when I was a teenager that I'm using today. And so, young people, if your parents tell you stuff and they continue to tell you stuff, listen to them. They've been down that road. You know, they know where you're headed. It may look different from your point of view, but you're going to get to where they are, and then you realize how smart they are. Yeah. So parents, keep telling them, keep teaching them the way of God, and they'll realize how smart you are.
This is getting good. I don't want to stop. All right, this is getting good. I just don't want to stop. Okay? Thank God who first in my life. Thank God for Pastor Hill and Mother Hill. Brother Rod broke the ice, but I'm going to melt the ice. I thank God for me because I never had a father. You probably heard this many times, but I never seen a father. My mother was a father, so she taught me the way of being a father. But once I saw it in other means, being a father, that was my life. But mostly all, God was my father. There's a lot of things that I got on my knees and prayed about, and He showed me the light. I was a father at 22 years old. When I turned 22, that's when my first son was born. And I was in college, and her father told me, he said, "You ain't going back to school. You taking care of my daughter." I said, "I'm going back to school." He said, "No, you're not." So I went home and told my mother. She said, "Don't worry about that. If you want to go to school, you go to school." But I had a heart. I said, "No, I'm not going to go to school. I'm going to take care of my kid." From the year he came out of his mother's womb, I had him in private school. I took care of him, took care of all his gang, went to the dentist, went to the hospital, went everywhere with my son. Everywhere my son went, we was together. We was like this. But it seemed like when you have a divorce, it just seemed like things break up. You know, you get two persons in the middle. One saying one thing, one saying another thing. And if one is not in Christ and one in Christ, you don't know which one they're going to lead to. But at the same time, me and my son just seemed like we just drift apart until he realized who I really was and came back to my life. But so happened I had another son. And then the second derail came up. When the second derail came up, his mother was just after. It was a point where I said, "Hey, let me have my son once he turned one, because I want to stay with his mother. Once he turned one, I've been taking care of the derail ever since he's been 1 year old.
Amen.
I worked, worked, and worked. The derail ain't never missed a meal. He never went dirty. He never went hungry.
He never went around and asked somebody for anything. I put him in private school ever since he was up to 5 years old. After he turned 5, he went to a public school and he out there in jinx. But what I'm trying to say, right today, Darrell is doing very good. He's very healthy. He don't want nothing. He see me come to church. He see me getting in his yard, working out here. He see me coming in here this morning. He see me on my knees praying. So Darrell look at me like, hey, this is a good dad. He's a very good dad. You know, my outer appearance is totally different, but my heart is the one that God's going to choose. Everyone want to say, hey, look what he look up from the outside, but you can't judge me from the outside. It's my heart. When it's time for us to go, each person going to be in this land one by one. He's going to see what type of clothes you have on. He's not going to see how much money you got in your pocket. He's not going to see what you did. He's going to see what's in your heart. What type of good father was you inside your heart? I can say for myself, I can't speak for no other man. I got to speak for Curtis Darrell Hawkins. My heart is a very good heart to my kids and to anyone else. Other people will have to say, hey, do you really know him from your heart? No, you don't know him from your heart. You just know from his outer person. But what about the inner person? I would do anything and anyone for anyone in this church if they come and ask me. It ain't one I never turned down. If you say, hey, I need this or I need that, I do it. It's no problem for me picking up or stopping what I'm doing to come help one of my church members. It's no problem. It's no problem for me putting a frown on my face. I won't put a frown on my face. So I'm saying from my heart, I'm a follower. I will help you any way I could. Any way I could. Any way I could, I will help anyone in this church. And I'm saying to myself, happy Father to every father here. And let the best come out each father on this day and every other day. God bless you.
All right. Brother Curtis, you were just, that was marvelous because it was different and you just don't want to hear all good stuff. You want to hear people that had some challenges and really have paid the price in a different way. So that was really different and very good. Okay, Brother Al. Let's give him a hand.
God blessed me with 3 children. 2 by my wife. She had 2 children when I first met her. And then she and I had a little baby boy. And we named him Isaiah. I got a little bit of a cold, the horse. But at the same time, God said, if you be willing and obedient, amen, he'll give you the fruit of the land. Yeah. He gave me everything. He gave me my wife and my 3 children. Amen. I want my children to always remember me as a praying man. All right. That's one thing that those children, all 3 of them, can say about me, is they always saw me on my knees praying. Amen. If I wasn't on my knees praying, I was either laying down praying, or I was walking through the house talking to God. I learned that when I grew up without a father. I knew my dad. I used to see my dad. I used to wave at my dad, and my dad wouldn't even wave back. So I felt bad. I didn't have that father figure. I didn't have anyone to tell me or teach me or show me how to be a father. Like Brother Curtis, my mother taught me how to be a father. And God bless her. But she told me as a little boy that one day I would be a father and that I would have children. And she told me that I would have to respect them and they would have to respect me. One thing I've done around my children is this. I wouldn't do anything that I wouldn't want them to do. I wouldn't want them to go out and cause harm to someone or be disobedient to someone. I've always tried to uphold myself and be a good man. My son Isaiah, the baby boy, a few months ago, he got in some trouble. I could have been the type of father to turn my back on my son. I could have ignored it. But I saw that he made a mistake. Like I made mistakes in my life. God saw the mistakes in my life, and God knows my heart. God knew me when before I was even born.
So God saw that it'd be a praying man, a man that stays on his knees, a man that prays all the time. He saw it'd be someone that had a good heart. When my son Isaiah did what he did, it caused a lot of embarrassment, it caused a lot of shame. But at the same time, I asked him, I said, son, all you got to do is tell the truth about what's going on. He came to me one Saturday night. He had big tears in his eyes. He told me, Dad, this is what I did. I didn't scold him. I didn't holler at him. I showed him love, kindness. I was gentle. No bitterness, no anger, no hate, no malice. All I wanted to show him was love. We had to go through some trials, going to court, things of that nature. And they wanted to certify my son as an adult. He was only 16 years old at the time, and I couldn't see it. But I kept praying, and I just kept praying. So what happened was, when we did go to court, well, before we went to court, one Monday night we were here praying, Sister Judy got up and said, sometimes you have to ask God for favor for your children. And they were going to try to certify my son as an adult. And that morning before we went to court, me and my wife and my son, we got up and we prayed. And as I prayed, I said, Lord, just give us faith. That's all I wanted was faith. Because my son's a good boy. Amen. So at that time, we went to court. We got there, and not knowing how everything was going to go, we were talking about trying to sent my boy to the penitentiary. He's just 16. I couldn't go for it. So I started praying in the spirit. I kind of took myself away and I prayed in the spirit. And we went into the courtroom and they talked and they talked. And the judge had my son to stand up. When he stood up, he said, Isaiah, he said, what we're going to do is we're going to keep you a juvenile, as a juvenile. That's where he should have been from the start. And at the same time, he looked at my son and he said, somebody has gave you faith. That's all I can say. Let's thank God that it's God that gave him faith. So what I'm trying to say right now is this. We can do a lot of things in life. We can make our spouses upset. We can make our children upset. But if you're a true man and a true man of God, if you stay on your bended knees, and I mean stay on your bended knees, talk to God every day. I'm going through trials right now, but I talk to God every day. And God will answer every prayer that you send up. I heard the Lord say, blessed is the man that walk not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor shall he sit in the seat of the scornful. But in his delight is the law of the Lord. And in his law he shall meditate day and night. He shall be like a tree that is planted by the rivers of water. And whatsoever he do shall prosper. So what I'm saying is, I prosper every day just by being as good as I possibly can and staying on my bended knees. Thank you.
People talk. about what they would be remembered as a father. Well, I'm here to represent the struggling fathers. I have a son, and my son and I have went through an up and down relationship of his life. And, you know, I was sitting there and I was wondering to myself, I don't know why I struggle so much with fatherhood, because I'm also going to speak for the stepfathers. And I have an example of two stepfathers in my life that just blew me away as fathers. And one was my own stepfather, who raised me from the time I was 8 years old. And the second one that came into my life was my wife's stepfather. And I just thought about, my stepfather took over two kids who were basically 7 or 8 years and 6 and 8 years old. And he raised us, and you talk about unconditional love. I never really knew in my household that that wasn't my real father, even though I was old enough to know that I could see my dad, as one of the brothers said. But, you know, I always thought that my stepfather was dead. Because he was always there. He was always trying. He was always working hard. He was always giving us something. He was always trying to instill in me what it was to be a man who finished what you start. Finished what you start. Work it till the end. Make sure that when you give something to somebody, that thing is correct and that it's right. And that's what my stepfather instilled in. Then as I got married and I met my wife's stepfather, was a different man. He took over 5 children and he worked hard. He tried to give each and every one of those children, he went on to have 2 more of his own, but he worked to try to give each and every one of them a try. But you know, in that, he also reached out to the rest of the family. And I think of fathers as people who reach out to the rest of the extended family. We were talking this morning in church about how our older generation used to take in the poor. Well, I think about my stepfathers, how they would reach out to the extended family and be there for them. And then, you know, fathers carry so many hats through the family. I think about how my father treated his wife and my stepfather. And I think about my wife's stepfather, how he treated my mother-in-law. And so, man, being a father has a lot of hats, just as mothers do. But, you know, it's something special about that dad that shows strength, and they show that unconditional love. And those are the things that I gathered from those two men. And so I wonder today, why do I struggle so hard sometimes with my son? But I know eventually, just as Brother Al said, if you keep praying, he's going to need me in some kind of way, and I need to be ready. The only way to get ready is to come into the church home, get myself established in the church home, pray, and then I know that God will send him to me in a way that I will be able to help him be an example to him. And, you know, I just want to finish on a funny note. You know, being a father, you can be a father to a lot of different people. Well, I'm a father to 3 little dogs. And believe me, sometimes they need you just as much as children. And I appreciate them, and I appreciate the love that they give me back, because I try to show love to them.
Well, I'm not young, but Salvation. sing it for the blind man who can see the light in me and come alone.
That came out of my pocket. My sons were very athletic. So, you know, when you're an athlete, you need stuff. And there's a lot of stuff that child support don't cover. So it was always in my pocket for shoes, gloves, shoulder pads, helmets, those kind of things, you know, which I, you know, had no problem with. Some years later, they moved back to Tulsa. My sons were just starting to get into seventh grade, still had one in elementary school. But a lot of, I would say love was lost, but so much time gone that the unity connection that we had when they were little was gone. And plus a lot of things that the mom said about me that had them believing that I wasn't a good father. But anyway, as the years went on, they began to be teenagers, and they started getting trouble in school, and their mother would call me. You know, I'd have to take off from work, go to school, see about them. They get kicked out, I'd go get them back in. They get kicked out, I'd go get them back in. And I had a job that when you take out from work, that's just money lost. When they become young men, one of the things that I did, I know was wrong. I was living in sin in a way, so it didn't really matter to me that much. When they got grown, I was already smoking marijuana and drinking and stuff. Now, I didn't introduce them to marijuana. But I smoked with them, sold it to them. They sold me some. We traded, we partied together, stuff like that. And then, as the years went by, I met Paulette. And after a few years of living in common law with her, of course, we got married. And when we got married, she brought me to church on that fateful day. And my life changed forever. I became a born again person. Amen. One of the things I had a real hang up with that I wasn't ready to give up at the time was marijuana. I was still very much dependent on it. So for a few months after I got saved, which I had promised God, just give me a little time and I can give this up to. So a few months after I got saved, I was smoking on this bag of marijuana and stuff, and I smoked and smoked till I couldn't smoke no more. And I just couldn't. I was full. Once I did stop, I was done with it. Now I made a critical mistake with that bag that I had left over. I called my son and I said, "Hey, come over here." You know, he came over and I gave it to him. And when I gave it to him, you know, he had the saddest look on his face. And he asked me, "Are you dying?" I said, "No." I said, "I'm dead, but I'm not dying." And the thing is, what I want them to remember me most about, they knew me as a party father, you know, stuff like that. But when I gave my life to Christ, it was a real shock to them. They couldn't understand it. They couldn't receive it. They didn't want to receive it. And them, just like so many people in my life, were just waiting for me to stumble. When I got saved, when I went to work, the very next day, told my friends that I gave my life to Christ. They said, "Hey, let's go to the strip club and celebrate." Oh. That was the kind of stuff that I used to do, you know. But my sons and a lot of other people that were close to me, as the time went on, and years passed, I didn't waver, I didn't falter. They never saw me slip. They never saw me with a joint in my hand or in my mouth, not even a cigarette. The things that they knew me to be, the things that they loved about me, they had to learn to love me all over again. And it took a while for them to do that. But if I had faltered in who I was, then that new love for their father would have never come or would have never lasted. So I thank God today that they got to see two dads. The dad that they knew and the dad that they know today. And out of all of that, being an absent father most of their lives, I pray for God to give me an opportunity, you know, to get it right this time. So years ago, I started praying that he'd give me my grandson. And he came into my life March of last year. And as of Friday, a week ago, June the 8th, my grandson is legally my son. The judge asked him, was he going to call me dad? He said, no. Said he's still grandpa. You know? And that's fine with me, because I was always grandpa. And I'll always be grandpa. And but I just want y'all to know that no matter what you do in life, no matter how many mistakes you make as a father, just never give up. God will make a way. If you want a change, if you want to do something different, be something different, God will make a way. Be persistent in your walk, in your prayers, and God will give you your heart's desire. Amen.
It was Sister Hill that intervened for Brother Travis when he was applying for custody of his child. And if Brother Travis didn't have the record and the track record that we knew him to have, because Sister Hill had to tell the truth. And because she was able to tell the truth about his faithfulness, his commitment to God, his commitment to the church, that was the thing that enabled him to have custody of that child today. Isn't that good?
Happy Father's Day to all the fathers. Just wanted to wish my dad a very happy, happy, happy Father's Day. And I'm sorry, my alarm clock was set for 6 p.m. One thing about my dad, it's like really hard to do things for them because they do everything at the crack of dawn. And I've just never been able to adjust to that. And it's like no matter, I can stay up all night just to be ready to wake up and do something, and I'll fall asleep right before they do. Or if he's up, I'm thinking I'm up ahead of him, and he's already outside getting the newspaper or something. But one thing I know about my dad, I can say, is he has always been really prayerful and is always busy and always at work, but he's always, you know, he's present. Even though he's doing things, he's constantly in motion. Even sometimes I see him around the house, and it's supposed to be a day where he's supposed to be relaxing and he's out doing something in the yard or he's out helping somebody move something. Anytime anybody calls, I mean, his phone ringing, people are constantly asking him for assistance or his knowledge and wisdom because he has a lot of it. And I can honestly say that if I would have listened years ago about certain situations and actually taking part of the wisdom that my dad, you know, has acquired in his life, and also from Pastor Hill, you know, from Northside, then I wouldn't be through certain situations that I've been in. And, you know, and thank the Lord that I have parents who are able to pray for me and help me and help move me through things, and they know how to do things the godly way that you can get out of situations and not be stuck in them. But one thing I can say about my dad, he's always dependable. No matter what, when, what time, and it's like, I know for for sure, and everyone else knows for sure, that you call him, he's there. He doesn't make you wait hours and hours. And I feel bad because every car that I've ever had has always gotten torn up, and I don't know how to explain it, but he doesn't ask me a lot of questions about it. He already knew that I was supposed to be tired and I didn't get to go. And he will come and get me, and we don't really have to talk about it and all of the extra disciplinary. I take care of myself, you know, I'll think about them and say, well, I could have did this, that, and the other. But, you know, I'm one of those people that have to learn from experience. I just never been one of those that you take it and really understand and grasp it without actually going through it, which really sucks. thank you. Here all week. But I really do want to say that I love and appreciate my father, and I really want to be able to, my goal in life is to be able to give back to my parents, and I haven't gotten to it, but it's like constantly striving. All of the things that I do, I keep, sometimes when I get discouraged in my work and all of the things that I'm working with in school, I remember that this is going to pay off. You have to work hard, and that's one thing I've learned is you work hard now, you can play later and be able to give back. So you just kind of in that stage and keep letting them know that, you know, one thing I know about my dad is dependable. He's a hard worker and he's a praying, God-fearing man. And the reason why is like, I'm looking for these qualities that I see in my dad, I see in other people, and it really does weed out the ones that aren't supposed to be there. So I do constantly think of the things, and I do really take some of those characteristics that I see in my dad and compare them to other people, and somehow the generations have gotten lost. But we have good role models. They are still here. And my sister's telling me I should hurry up, but I don't rush. But my dad is still in the living. I want to let him know how much I appreciate him. For us and for other people. And I mean, the boyfriend that I have now says, you know, your dad is awesome. He's like, I want to be like him. I want to be like him. And I see that, and that keeps me focused, like I'm doing something right. And my dad is a great template. And I hope one day that I do marry someone like him and I'm able to be a good parent so that I can produce children that'll be in there, so that there is God-fearing people being duplicated generation after generation in the world. And Diana wants to say something about her daddy.
Happy Father's Day, Daddy. I love you. Quiet.
Then I started trying to go back to church, you know, come to church. Then I started seeing Glenn. He got up there and I was like, Glenn, talk. He was at home. He was just on every time I started in on something, Mama just thought, you know, Mama gonna be Mama. But then we just praying, Lord. That's all I heard was Lord. Every time song went on, he was right there. He was right there. Praying, Lord, Lord. And then I was like, okay, well, he a cool man. I didn't ever take the time to realize what I had. Because I was always trying to hold on to the fact that I was thinking my daddy might come through the door. Even though I saw him being buried, I was like, he coming back. He gonna come back. And I'm like, okay, all right, so okay, I gotta grow up. Angie, you gotta grow up. This took maturing, this took time. Oh, it was years, because I had matured, and I had to ask God to help me deal with this, because it just happened, you know. From me being from princess to, you know, so, and standing here, I'm like, well, Glenn has always been there. He always been around. Every time something was going on, I had my babies, and he was always there. How you doing? You all right? And I'm like, okay. He's still a cool man. All right. And then when you talk to him, he actually have a conversation. Or he was praying for me because I was always doing something. So that was it. He was quiet. He was like, Lord, did you come with something? And I'm just praying right now for him. But you know what? I love you. All right.
Make sure I did good in sports and good in school. And
He always made the right decisions, and he never took my side if I did something wrong. And he made sure I was disciplined and I was respectful to him and other people.
Amen.
That's it.
Amen.
Couldn't have the neighborhood
put kids in it. That's exactly how I am now. Like, I want you in my house. So the next day I come back and it's gone. So I want to say I thank my father for that. He is always there when I need him, where there's money, whether, you know, I need some help with my car, anything like that. And I just want to say I love you, Daddy, very much. I know I should say it more. But I love you a lot, and I want to say thank you.
Amen.
Can you turn this off now? Okay, just before we have closing remarks from Brother Donnell, he has something that he wants to say. Is there anybody else that didn't get a chance to give your say? Okay.
Amen.
Oh, okay, Amber, you can come right now so we can. Okay.
Amen. Amen.
All right. Well, come on. You can come on. Okay. Let me see how better do this. Okay. Y'all can just come on down. Okay. What I wanted to do, I wanted to receive an offering. And don't look suspicious or fighting or cynical, because I believe that the workman is worthy of his hire. Not only are they involved in the Sunday school, in the nursery, but some of y'all have been under Brother Daniel's teaching Sunday after Sunday for God knows how long. And so I think that at some point we ought to realize that people that minister to us and people that feed us and share the word of God, they are due a blessing periodically, amen, in a big way. And this is how we show our appreciation to people that have worked and labored down through the years. So we need it. Okay. Sister Amber, Sister Yvonne. All right. Okay.
Good morning. I just want to thank you, Father's Day, to all the fathers. And I just, I love my dad so much. And I just couldn't sit there because it's best to just say while you're here and how much you love and appreciate him. I just appreciate growing up here in Northside and just, you know, the teachings that I learned from Pastor Hill. It's just, you know, just made me the woman that I am today. And I just love and appreciate my dad so much. He's oh my goodness, he's the best dad. I am his little girl. And I always will be his little girl. me and Elena both, my little girl, we're both just wrapped around so tight. He is the best father. I just thank him so much for just being the head of the house and just, you know, being that example. So, Shawanda, you were so right. You know, I see my dad get up at the crack of dawn every day, go to work. He had to be at work at like 5-something at American. And my husband has to be at work at 4-something. And I'm like, oh my gosh, cutting yards. My dad cut yards. My husband cuts yards. It's like, you see that. And it's just like, okay, you know, you see what a good man is, and that's what you want. You know, as young women, you see that, so you don't have to bear off. So, I just thank God for Northside Christian Center so much. I do thank him and everybody. And I love my dad so much, so I had to get up and say that.
That's
good. He's great. That's what I was
saying. Sing for us. I thought
that was a little bit. Good morning. Road. I was raised by my stepfather. I met my father, real father, when I was 7. He stayed in Los Angeles. When I met him at 7, that's all I could think about is my father. I got a real father. And he did at the time try to sit in my knee, but my stepfather kind of didn't like the idea of me knowing my father and having feelings for me. So he had stopped the papers. And when he said it, he was saying my name. And I was like 8 or 9, and I got to write my name on the back of the money roll. And I thought, like, well, this is mine. And we stayed apart. In those, I say 40 years, I might have seen my father probably 5 times, because we lived in L.A. He came here, and I got to see him. Maybe 5 or 6. But when he came into my life when I was 40, we rejoined, and we've been tight like this since. After my husband died, he took over, then I never said a word. I just woke up, the trash can would be on the corner. I would wake up and hear lawnmowers running. He'd be out cutting my yard, his yard, and it's never nothing he turned down. But I wanted him to know today, those 20 years we was apart, it was not your fault. Because when he came back, he thought, I should have done better. You did do better. God don't look at what you did in the past. Now, whatever you done, I love you, and I want to say happy birthday, happy Father's Day to you. And you're going to be there for me, and I'll be there for you, always.
All right. I want to just add to that, Brother Leslie, we're just so glad to see you this morning.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Brother Leslie is a very gentle, nice, everything I've ever asked him to do. Amen. Except come to church. He was willing to do it. And the day he came, amen. Praise the Lord. So, Brother Leslie, we want to see more of you, and we're just so happy for you today. And you've always done everything I've asked. He come down here to Cleveland Church, and I mean, he's willing to do anything. Amen. So I think that we're going to get him to start coming a little bit more. Y'all believe that? All right. Let's give him a hand. All right. All right. Brother Daniel, this will be off the first before 12:30 comes. People watching the clock. Just a hill away to say. She'll make it today. She don't need it, I'm not speaking. Okay, we're going to ask everybody to stand, and we just believe that the message, it was just wonderful this morning. All of those responses, I don't believe that this could have been better today, nighter, more appropriate for the occasion. I just believe that a strong message today was released and to the hearts of many of you that were listening. And I think that probably the message you heard today probably will go even deeper in your hearts than anything that I would have said. So I just believe that the steps of a good man are ordered up on. Amen. So we're going to receive this offering today, this special offering. This is not just an ordinary offering. This is going to be a special love token. And we just thank God for each one of you that have heard the voice of the Lord and you're given out of your heart and given some of you out of your need. So we just want to pray God's blessings now. And we want each one of you to come and give as the Lord has prospered you after we pray this prayer, and after that, Brother Daniel will come and have remarks. And we're going to have a closing prayer for the Masons. I understand that he lost his mother. We're going to have a closing prayer for them, and we're going to have a closing prayer for all of the fathers as well. All right, now, Father, we thank you for your blessings. We thank you for what our ears have heard and the message that has resounded in our hearts. Lord, we receive all that you have said through all of these, your vessels. We give you praise and the glory. And Father, we pray your blessings upon this special offering. We believe that we are going to be able, God, to express our gratitude and our love and appreciation for those that have ministered entirely in this ministry and on the behalf of each one of us. Father, we give you praise and the glory in Jesus' name. Everybody said, praise the Lord. Amen. All right. Amen. From the rear, from the rear, from the rear, all the back. You know, ask you to come.
Oh, I thank you. Love you all for your offering. If you want to go to give financially, God bless you. Make sure you give me a goodbye kiss. Father's kiss. Hallelujah. I already remember this, the guy who, the father who took elaborate vacations. Tahoe, Long Beach, Huntington Beach. Let's take a while there in the last few years vacation. Cancun. Now Hawaii. Glory. I want to go to Jamaica. Cancun again. So I said, well, why don't you just go to your garage and put it out? All right, you do that on your vacation. By the way, on my vacation, I'm getting out of here. Amen. I might come back, praise God. I might find my way back, praise God. It's good to go to God's playground with the world, amen? Amen, praise God. I believe God gave it to us to have good things to enjoy in life, praise God. And we should enjoy the good things in life. So take a time out. We talk about the seventh day. Take a rest. We talked about that in Sunday school this morning. Take a rest, praise God. Jesus himself got away. Take a rest, praise God. So we thank God for you contributing to our taking a rest. It's been planned a year ago. And 2 months ago, I started planning for Cancun next year. So, glory to God. And after that, pretty soon, maybe Jamaica, maybe somewhere in Europe. But how do you just do it? Praise God. It's there. Amen. Amen. So what I want to be remembered about as a father is, how many heard on the news this week? A mother nourished in love and all like that. How many heard about the child, a five-year-old, I believe, was attempted sexual assault, and the dad punched him out till he killed him? Anybody remember that kid? That's a father's job. He said, what, should we throw him in jail because he killed a guy? No, give him a trophy. Mothers nourish, father kills. Father prepares for life. Let him know what life is all about. What is it's the easy stuff, it's the hard stuff, this is how you get through it, praise God. Mom is there to nourish. So I appreciate my father for what he's done in my life and how they talked about his father and his grandfather. We just had a family reunion a couple, 2 or 3 weeks ago. We got to see where everyone comes from, but the father plays a major role. So they were talking about dad. So being a father, I spoiled my girls. I raised my son to be tough, use his head, think. Bring it back to the Bible, all of my kids. Bring it back to the Bible, what are you thinking about? See if what you are thinking, fit what God is thinking. And then move forward, praise God. And always do everything scripturally. So I was always there. My kids never knew the life I had before I got saved. They never saw me smoke, they never saw me drink. They never saw any of that, so they probably thought I was a stiff. But as a young guy, I did all of that stuff, but the weed and all like that, it just got completely not worth anything when I heard I had a baby boy on the way. Life changed. Parenthood kicks in, and stuff is serious now. So, I raised them, took care of them. When they coughed at night, it wasn't candy jumping up all the time, it was me. I heard it before they coughed. Sneeze, it's like I was just stuck. That's how my dad is, praise God. It's just stuff is in him, praise God. So it's really easy being a father. You have to try very hard not to be one, for what I'm thinking. But you have to do all you can not to be one. It's just a natural thing that's given to you by God to protect. It's part of what God is. And a true father, you know what the Heavenly Father is like, your earthly father is doing his best to pattern after him. And the devil doesn't want that to happen. He do all he can to mess it up. He do all he can to mess that pattern up. But a true father is nothing but what your heavenly father is on earth, except when he's here, hands on. Hallelujah. That's the best I can put it that way. So I love my kids, and they all know that. And I love everyone else's kids. I pour into the life of other kids. Basketball teams at the family reunion. I met one of the girls I used to coach. You remember they used to coach me and so and so and so and so? And I said to myself, yeah, sure do. I said, that's the last girls coach team, a team I ever coached again in my life, and that is true, praise God. But yeah, I remember coaching everyone else's kids. So I see a lot on the street these days and say, hey, hi, you show me how to be a winner, you show me this. So I said, you know, so you pour into everyone else's life, kids' life, and you have kids all over the place. So that's all I have to say about fatherhood. But one other thing is that I think it's important that my kids know that I love their mom. That's my girl. I sniff her out, both my brains. That's my woman. I want them to know that, that they dad love their mom. Praise God. So, so I want my girls to know, yeah, not only do you deserve a $100 skirt, you deserve a $1 million home. That's what your man's supposed to do for you, so you figure that out. When you go, when a man come knocking on your door, I want to date your daughter, check him out. When he buy her $1 million home? That's right, God. Be careful. So she knows that, no, you don't get cheap stuff. They don't bring you cheap stuff. They bring you the real deal. She had a basketball coach. And I hate to start picking on Kristen because I got to pick on all the rest of them, but she had a basketball coach. She made her run. They hear fuss. I said, you and Jessica. They said, you can't talk. My daddy don't even talk to me. So they straight out the coach. You can't talk to me like that. Who do you think you are? I can't remember who it was, her and Jessica, praise God. But that's just some of the things I think about to go on and allow my kids, praise God. But you have to make the example. This is how a man acts when he's a father, right? This is how a man acts. Because they look back to my dad. That's how my dad looks. Okay. I think we should pray for the fathers today. Amen. We want to pray for brother, and I can't call the name. Yeah, the Masons. We want to pray for the Masons because give them strength, spiritual strength. So if they'll come down, we want to go ahead and lay the hands on them. As a couple, as a family, come on down. We want to pray their strength in the Lord. Hallelujah. There's nothing like mom. You can always count on mom no matter what, praise God. And I can almost sense the loss. Hallelujah, because my mom's in a serious situation. But so I know what he went through, what he's going through. But whatever, your mom is still with you, you still got it. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Praise God. And I want to get the brothers to come on down. Praise God. All the fathers, come on down. Praise God. We want to pray as a family, as brothers together. Brother Travis brought a mission meeting tomorrow, Tuesday. I'm making preparations to get out of here, okay? But you guys think about some grilled fish on the grill. How can we grill some fish on the grill? Okay? Praise God. Hallelujah. Glory, glory, glory. Let's the church all sit together. Let's pray for them. Hallelujah. Glory. Let's make hands. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we stand here in faith to pray the prayer of faith. Hallelujah. We thank you for the strength, the knowledge of you, through the word. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you that the word would be their strength. Hallelujah. They can go to the rock that's higher than them. Hallelujah. The word never falls. Never perishes, it's steadfast, it shows your faithfulness throughout every generation. So now they are the generation leaders. Hallelujah. For one perish, another is still there, because your word is from generation to generation. Your goodness, your mercy. Hallelujah. Father, strengthen them through your word. Hallelujah. Through the fellowship of believers. Hallelujah. Through the fellowship of the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. We thank you for their strength. Hallelujah, that you give to them. The inner man. Hallelujah. There's some peace and quiet. He's a great price in each and every one of them, Father. Strengthen them. We give you all the praise because you are sufficient in every area that they need. From finances to health, hallelujah, to peace of mind, a soulish man, to whatever they need, they can find it in your presence and in your word. We give you all the praise. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Bless these fathers. Hallelujah. From the young to the oldest. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Give them godly wisdom. Hallelujah. Give us wisdom that's from on high. Hallelujah. consistent. Hallelujah. We thank you, Father, that you are a way maker. You provide for us. Hallelujah. You give us our meat in due season. Hallelujah. We increase the fruits of our righteousness so we can abound to even more good works. We give you all the praise and glory. We thank you for blessing the head of this church, the pastor, the shepherd that feeds us. Hallelujah. He lays the table out as you give it to him. Prepare the spiritual food for us. Hallelujah. Strengthen and encourage him the more. Hallelujah. According to your word, we do all things through Christ that strengthens us. We give you all the praise and glory. In Jesus' name, the church said, amen.
That is able to keep us from falling and to present us faultless before his presence with exceeding great joy. To the only wise God, our Savior, be glory, honor, dominion, and power, both now and forever. Everybody said, praise the Lord. Amen. Also, I just want to say that our singers, those that have been really, really faithful, because they put a lot of time in, and we're going to have certain Sundays that we're going to take them out to eat, or either let you cook, or Sister Hila cook. A lot of times they like to go out too. All right, let's say praise the Lord for our singers as well. Amen.